Hi everybody, welcome back to another episode of the ADHD Writers Workshop, where writing is awesome.
Let's get this party started!
Whenever we write, we try to communicate a message. So let's talk about some of the rhetorical appeals that we can use as writers to effectively get our messages across to our audiences. Rhetoric is the art of effective or persuasive speaking or writing, especially the use of figures of speech and other compositional techniques.
Okay, sure. Right. So, why don't you explain what that is so they can understand?
Yeah,
just explain what that is.
Explain what you think that is.
Rhetorical strategies, then, are different ways you can write in order to have certain persuasive and effective elements in your writing that help you communicate your larger message or theme. The ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle wrote a lot about rhetoric, but let's first focus on three main rhetorical appeals that he thought were essential to effective writing: ethos, pathos, and logos. Ethos refers to the credibility or trustworthiness of the author. Ethos appeals show us why the author is qualified to communicate their message.
Why don't you go home and cry to your granny? Dolph, tie up the brat. Lisa, hold the book. Vincent, get the truck. And Keith, darn it, change your name, please. That's not scary, and I'm embarrassed to say it. Boris, try that. Keith, you know? Oh, watch out for Keith.
These appeals are commonly found in product advertisements, when the author tries to get the audience to choose their product or organization because some credible person endorses it, lending the message a sense of credibility.
I'm Michael Jordan. McDonald's restaurants have given me this time to talk to you about something we both really care about, kids. Kids are the reason McDonald's sponsors their Get It Straight program, a national drug awareness effort.
Pathos is usually referred to as an emotional appeal. An author would use a pathos appeal to play on their audience's emotions or perspective in order to communicate the author's idea.
Shrek!
Oh, come on, Donkey, look at him in his wee little boots. You know, how many cats can wear boots? Honestly. Oh, let's keep them.
Say what?
Oh. Popular examples of pathos appeals are those commercials that try to get you to adopt puppies by showing you these black and white clips of cute puppies with all the sad music in the background, because they're trying to play on your emotions and make you want to give these dogs a new home because you feel bad for them. I will be there for you. Logos refers to logical appeals, such as providing statistics, showing practical applications of the author's idea, or otherwise appealing to the audience's sense of logic.
Aren't you Patrick Star?
Yep.
And this is your ID?
Yep.
I found this ID in this wallet, and if that's the case, this must be your wallet.
That makes sense to me.
Then take it.
It's not my wallet.
These kinds of appeals can be found anywhere you find someone trying to convince their audience with research, facts, or logic. You'll also see good examples of logos appeals in mystery stories, when the author writes the story so that the audience can figure out the mystery before the detectives in the story figure it out, if you pay attention to the clues. One recent mystery movie, Knives Out, leaves plenty of clues throughout the movie for the viewer to find out who the actual killer is before the end reveal, although you have to be very attentive to find them.
Marta, when Great Nana spotted you climbing down the trellis, she said,
"Ransom, are you back again already?
Are you back again already? Because earlier that night,
Ransom, you're back."
All the little details and bits of information throughout the movie build a logical chain that makes the ending so much more convincing. Seriously, go watch that movie if you've never seen it. Although those are the three big rhetorical appeals, there are a bunch of other ones that are really cool too. For instance, have you ever wondered why Yoda talks like he does?
I can't. It's too big.
Size matters not. Look at me. Just me by my size, do you?
Yoda speaks according to adjunction, a rhetorical device in which the verb is placed at the end or the start of the sentence. For instance, do or do not, there is no try, is an example of the verb coming at the start of the sentence. Without adjunction, this sentence would read, there is no try, do or do not. Similarly, judge me by my size, do you, would change to, do you judge me by my size? Notice how the focus changes from you to the verb judge. Yoda is putting emphasis on these verbs, which makes his sayings very action-oriented. This concept changes the balance and focus of the sentence by changing the places of the subject and the verb, much like the it plus be verb clauses that we discussed a few weeks ago. I'll link that video in the description, as well as some more sources about how to use adjunction in your own writing, so make sure to check those out. Thinking about why an author uses a rhetorical device is called rhetorical analysis, and it can help you understand stories, arguments, and any other kind of communication. Knowing more about rhetoric will also help you write more convincingly and stylistically, so let's talk about a couple more strategies. Anaphora is a strategy where you start several sentences in a row with the same word or phrase. This concept is commonly used in poetry to change the balance, meter, and rhythm of each line. Take Sonnet 66, written by Shakespeare, for example. Notice how each of these lines all start with the same word. Almost the whole poem is just one sentence. You can use anaphora in your writing or communication to change balance and coordination, portray a sense of urgency, or define a rhythmic pattern. Listen to this clip from one of my favorite movies, La La Land, and pay attention to how both characters repeat the same phrases or words at the start of their sentences and how that adds a sense of urgency and tension to their conversation.
Why? I've been to a million auditions, and the same thing happens every time, where I get interrupted because someone wants to get a sandwich, or I'm crying and they start laughing, or there's people sitting in the waiting room and they're like me but prettier and better at the, because maybe I'm not good enough.
Yes, you are.
No, maybe I'm not.
Yes, you are.
Maybe I'm not.
You are.
Maybe I'm not.
You are.
Induction is when you try to make a general conclusion based on a specific image, example, or piece of evidence. You might have heard of deduction before, which is just the opposite, when you make a specific conclusion based on general images, examples, or pieces of evidence, like Sherlock Holmes and his brother Mycroft.
Let's do deductions. Client left this while I was out. What do you reckon? Isolated too, don't you think?
Why would he be isolated?
He?
Obviously.
Why, size of the head?
Don't be silly. Some women have large heads, too. No, he's recently had his hair cut. You can see the little hairs adhering to the perspiration stains on the inside.
Some women have short hair, too.
Balance of probability.
Not that you've ever spoken to a woman with short hair, or you know a woman.
Stain show is out of condition, and he's sentimental because the hat has been repaired
five times. Very neatly. The cost of the repairs exceeds the cost of the hat, so he's mawkishly attached to it, but it's more than that. One, perhaps two patches would indicate sentimentality. But five? Five's obsessive behavior. Obsessive compulsive.
On the other hand, this clip from Brooklyn Nine-Nine is a great example of induction.
Whoa, what's with the cast?
I sprained my wrist.
Oh no, what happened?
Don't worry about it. I'm fine.
Yeah, geez, Amy. Back off. Leave the guy alone.
All right, huddle up. Everybody, bring it in. Bring it in. So he wouldn't say what happened, which can only mean one thing.
He's in a fight club.
No.
Induction can be a good way to look at specific evidence and draw conclusions about larger ideas, but let's try to avoid overreacting and coming to unrealistic conclusions that can hurt your argument. Thanks everyone so much for supporting this channel with your viewership, I really appreciate you. Be sure to check the description for a summary of today's video and my sources. Shoot me an email if you have any ideas for future episodes, feedback for my channel, questions about rhetoric, or anything else, really. And also, you can let me know if you have some of your own work you'd like me to revise or feature on my channel. I'm always open to collaborate or make some stuff happen here. If you liked today's video, make sure to stick around for my next video about punctuation, where we'll learn about how you can use punctuation to write more stylistically instead of just looking at it as a set of rules that you have to follow. And I think that's it for me today, so make sure to have a good day, and I will see you next time.